So the tale you know was told by men who twist the truth to fit their means, of the glory won by Beowulf, who doled out death with a blade so keen. In the hoary land of Denmark, not far from Geatland shores, old King Hrothgar's home and hearth had blood upon its floors. A creature from the mere, known by Grendel for his maw, stalked the halls of Heorot to crunch the Danes within his jaw. Each night he came a-hunting from the forests near his bog to gobble Danes, Goths, and Brondings, then slip away into the fog. He heard their cries across the sea, our Beowulf of the sword, and took a pack of Geats in tow to kill the beast for a golden hoard. Mighty old King Hrothgar sighed relief when Geats arrived. Familiar with the war tribe, he sought the demon's quick demise. The scent of human flesh wafted in from the salty shore, and Grendel went a-bounding. He took delight in feasting more. Then Grendel saw this Beowulf. He looked different from the others. Something odd, something amiss. In another life, they could be brothers. They locked arms in the mead hall, the monster and his slayer, and fought for one long night, till an arm cracked and teared. Grendel screeched, Grendel brayed, he howled at the moon. But Beowulf kept tugging, the sinew snapped in certain doom. The hero held aloft the arm, like a trophy to the sky. The monster loped back to his swamp, to lay down and die. And mead flowed back in Heorot, Dane and Geat embraced as brothers. How could they have known? The Grendel had a mother. She came clawing from the banks, revenge stirred her heart. She would find the beast called Man, and rip them all apart. There asleep in Heorot, lay the drunken Danes, and high among the rafters, the arm from her son of Cain. She shred down the door, she shrieked a harsh alarm, she grabbed the arm and one dumb Dane to take him back and do some harm. Soon the rumor spread, not one fiend but two, they rallied round Beowulf, who knew just what to do. He tracked the she-beast to her lair, a fire swamp full of snakes. He took a breath, dove down deep, swam to the bottom of the lake. He emerged from the shadows to find a cave full of treasure. There she was, tall and fierce, to defeat her no small measure. He drew his sword and swung it hard. The blade sung inside the room, but when it hit her thorny hide, it splintered, cracked, thoom! She grabbed him by his throat, but stronger than her son. She tossed him at the treasure. He landed bruised, far flung. Beowulf felt the battle waning, his mood was growing dim. She was stronger, she was faster, his chances far too slim. Then amidst the hoard, his fingers caught a glance, a pommel, a hilt, a sword. He gripped a new lance. Forged in Wayland's fires, before the earth bore iron or men, Nagling, an ancient sword was made, for gods to wield, to defend. Beowulf took that well-made tool. He got up and stood his ground. The sea hag swiped a claw his way. He struck her once. She fell in a mound. The great Geat lord had rid the land of a curse from ages past. He piled his longship high with gold and traveled home neath the fair mast. 50 years upon the throne was Beowulf king of the domain, and people spoke far and wide of his deeds. But the slayer's work is never done, even when his bones do creak. The dragon looms its thorny head to threaten the young and weak. So the final task was set before him for this monster slayer of old, to rid the beast or die trying for Beowulf's deeds to be told. At least, that's as men have told it, as I said, they twist the truth. Too blind to know the proper tale, but kings run rampant youth.